Nada. Thank you, Doug. As we gather together, there is some technical information that most of you already know, but just in case someone does not. There is a copy of the service in the Red Book next to the door to the sanctuary. I think we all know that tonight. The service will be in voice and text. Worship music will be in the media player. And thank you for not touching the media player. We've learned the hard way that if you poke it, it gets cranky, and the video stops playing for everyone. So if the player isn't working in your viewer, please follow the YouTube link. And before I talk about the gathering music, I'm going to point out that at least one of us probably looks like an orange blob tonight. Second Life is just plain having problems. So if you are watching from Facebook land or on the YouTube later, this is just one of the funny little glitches that sometimes happens in Second Life, and everything will be. So, there's an element of today's lesson that I read as a human desire to know and be loved by someone who is untamable. You could even say,
climb so high, I never wanna die.
Well, welcome everyone. Oh, a 20-minute presentation. See, I should be cleaning the apartment because I'm going to have guests tomorrow. And I have to sleep sometime. Maybe I'll take the 20 minutes. That'd be great. Well, welcome everyone. Welcome to First United Church of Christ and Conference Center Second Life. We have officially an association of the Southern California Nevada Conference of the United Church of Christ as a real life church located in Second Life. And I still think that's pretty cool because I have sat in South Central Pennsylvania, I've sat in Northern Maine, and I'm currently sitting in Central Connecticut. And I still think it's pretty cool that we can partner with my brothers and sisters all across the country and all of you, wherever you are. Speaking of wherever you are, no matter who you are, or where you are on life's journey, you are here. Most churches have a time of offering, making an offering, sharing what you can in God's name is spiritual practice. That offering can be one of prayer or of presence, of work on behalf of the church, doing things like reading scripture or serving on the board of directors, of hosting social events or being a guide, of leading Psalter or participating in church governance by being a voting member, of helping with any of the many things that are needed for the church to function, and or that offering can be one of money. As a UCC church, we support the work of the wider church, both with prayer and with donations, as do all UCC churches. And it's true that we don't have a physical building, but there are monetary costs for this ministry to function. So if you would like to make an offering by participating in leading worship or social events, or if you would like to become a member of this church, let any clergy or staff member know. If you'd like to make a financial offering to support this ministry, there is a donation bowl by the door to the sanctuary. Or if you prefer, you can make a donation in real-life currency on our website. And since we are a 501c3 public charity, monetary donations are tax-deductible in the U.S. We thank you for the blessing of your presence and your offering of support. Scripture lesson today is from the book of Exodus. Moses said to the Lord, "See, you have said to me, bring up this people, but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. Yet you have said, I know you by name, and you have also found a favor in my sight. Now, if I have found favor in your sight, show me your ways so that I may know you and find favor in your sight. Consider, too, that this nation is your people." He said, "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." And he said to him, "If your presence will not go, do not carry us up from here. For how shall it be known that I have found favor in your sight, I and your people, unless you go with us? In this way we shall be distinct, I and your people, from every people on the face of the earth." The Lord said to Moses, "I will do the very thing that you have asked, for you have found favor in my sight, and I know you by name." Moses said, "Show me your glory, I pray." And he said, "I will make all my goodness pass before you, and will proclaim before you the name Lord. And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. But," he said, "you cannot see my face, for no one shall see me and live." And the Lord continued, "See, there is a place by me where you shall stand on the rock. And while my glory passes by, I will put you in a cleft of the rock, and I will cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will take away my hand, and you shall see my back, but my face shall not be seen." Last time I preached for you, we talked about the whole debacle with the golden calf. I argued that the people wanted something more stable than the man, Moses, to be the intermediary between themselves and the awesome and awful and awe-inspiring God up on the mountain. The one whose glory was even then wreathed in fire and smoke and thunderclouds up. Flesh melting, no one shall see them and live, God, upon the mountain. The God of their ancestors, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the one who brought them up out of Egypt. They needed an intermediary between themselves and the God that chose them, and Moses kept doing things like going up on the mountain and then not coming back down again. And please, make that intermediary something certain and easy, manageable. The problem with the golden calf, of course, is that it's an idol. We talked all about that last time I preached, so I won't repeat it here. But I am going to borrow a metaphor from elsewhere in the Bible to describe the outcome at the stage for today's lesson. Think of God as a romantic partner. They love Israel, and they propose marriage. And Israel says yes. And they all immediately begin planning the wedding and figuring out what it's going to look like to live together. And Israel gets drunk and sleeps with someone else, even though God specifically said that was a deal breaker. There's a huge fight that the lectionary skips right over and lands us here, with God and Israel sitting across the kitchen table from each other over mugs of coffee and renegotiating the relationship. Where do we go from here? I find it beautiful and amazing, actually, that they don't break up, you know? Not a perfect metaphor, of course, because we're talking about the relationship between God and a whole nation full of people. Moses and God are not sitting across the kitchen table from each other, but I believe that it's still an apt metaphor. God and the people established boundaries that the people broke. And now they have to reestablish boundaries if the relationship is going to continue. God and Moses and the people aren't sitting across the kitchen table from each other. Moses pitched a tent outside the camp, and the pillar of cloud would descend and stand at the entrance of the tent, and the Lord would speak with Moses face to face as he would with a friend. Trust was broken, and trust takes some time and effort to heal. And so Moses is in an incredibly delicate position here. He has his own very special relationship with God, and he stands in solidarity with the people in the camp. It's worth remembering that when those people broke God's trust, God suggested that they wipe the people off the face of the earth and start over, Moses. Then, as now, Moses stands with the people arguing for God to give them another chance. Luckily for the people, as James Newsom writes, when justice and compassion clash within the heart of Yahweh, compassion prevails. As he argues for the people, Moses does sound like a desperate romantic partner. You still love me? We're nothing without you. If you love me, please make this big gesture to prove it. Well, God does love Moses, and they do love the people. It really is the presence of God that makes them the chosen people, not any inherent goodness on their part. Actually, there's a word for that, right? It's called grace. And God does give Moses the asked-for big gesture, except that God also establishes some boundaries. I will make all my goodness pass before you and will proclaim before you the name of the Lord. And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. But you cannot see my face, for no one shall see me and live. See, there is a place by me where you shall stand on the rock. And while my glory passes by, I will put you in a cleft of the rock, and I will cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will take away my hand, you shall see my back, but my face shall not be seen. No longer I am who I am, or I will be who I will be, but the Lord. You can experience all of my goodness, but only the palm of my hand and my back, not my face. There are a couple of things I need to point out here. First, this is a new boundary for Moses. He's used to speaking to God face to face as he would a friend. And it's not just a new boundary for Moses. The end of his part of the story tells us that there was never another prophet who spoke with God in that way. Then Moses went up from the plains of Moab to Mount Nebo, the top of Pisgah, which is opposite Jericho. And the Lord showed him the whole land. Gilead, as far as Dan, all Naphtali, the land of Ephraim and Manasseh, the land of Judah, as far as the western sea, the Negev and the plain, that is the valley of Jericho, the city of palm trees, as far as Zoar. The Lord said to him, "This is the land of which I swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, saying, I will give it to your descendants. I've let you see it with your eyes, but you shall not cross over there." Then Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab at the Lord's command. He was buried in a valley in the land of Moab, opposite Beth Peor, but no one knows his burial place to this day. Moses was 120 years old when he died. His sight was unimpaired, and his vigor had not abated. The Israelites wept for Moses in the plains of Moab for 30 days. Then the period of mourning for Moses was ended. Joshua, son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom because Moses had laid his hands on him, and the Israelites obeyed him, doing as the Lord had commanded of Moses. Never since has there arisen a prophet in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. He was unequaled for all the signs and wonders that the Lord sent him to perform in the land of Egypt. Against Pharaoh and all his servants and his entire land, and for all the mighty deeds and all the terrifying displays of power that Moses performed in the sight of all Israel. Now, the second thing I want to mention is that there's an incredible tension here. God as holy, face-melting, God as holy, face-melting mystery. And God with hands and back and face, embodied like you and me, all in the same moment. T.S. Lewis understood that tension when he wrote about Aslan the lion. "Who is Aslan?" asked Susan. "Aslan?" said Mr. Beaver. "Why, don't you know? He's the king. It is not you that will save Mr. Tumnus." "Is he a man?" asked Lucy. "Aslan a man?" said Mr. Beaver sternly. "Certainly not. I tell you he is the king of the wood and the son of the great emperor beyond the sea. Don't you know who is the king of beasts? Aslan is a lion. The lion. The great lion." "Oh," said Susan. "I thought he was a man. Is he quite safe? I shall feel rather nervous about meeting a lion." "That you will, dearie, and no mistake," said Mrs. Beaver. "If there's anyone who can appear before Aslan without their knees knocking, they're either braver than most or else just silly." "Then he isn't safe?" said Lucy. "Safe?" said Mr. Beaver. "Don't you hear what Mrs. Beaver tells you? Who said anything about safe? Of course he isn't safe, but he's good. He's the king, I tell you." "I'm longing to see him," said Peter, "even if I do feel frightened when it comes to the point." Which brings me to my final point today. It may be true that never since has there arisen a prophet in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. But as a Christian, I believe that in Jesus we have an aspect of God that we can know face to face and speak to as a friend. But I also believe that it is a mistake to lose that tension. God is still a holy, face-melting mystery. And God still has hands and back and face, bodied like you and me, all in the same moment. Yes, we have a friend in Jesus. But that does not mean that his teachings are easy or that we should ever be completely certain about how to follow them. And safe? Of course he isn't safe. But he's good. What do you say? Amen? So I know I kissed my hand with Steppenwolf, but there's something about Moses wanting to see the glory of God and God covering Moses with their hand that feels very loving, very moving. Which, of course, is not the same thing as saying that God could ever. Good catch, everybody. Thank you. Let me go back. We have come to our time in worship that I really do believe is the core of what we do here together. And that is where we uplift our joys and concerns with one another in prayer. And so I would like to invite you to enter this time of prayer with a sense of reverence. We're about to enter into a conversation with God, and that shouldn't be done lightly, but rather with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. So please type your prayers into chat, or if you need to use voice, simply emote raising your hand so everybody can have a voice. As we pray together, you may wish to respond to others with words like, God, hear our prayer, or with any other words the Spirit leads you to use. And so with Jerome, we pray with gratitude that Sally is safely in California and here with us. And for all our staff and friends who make this ministry possible in a challenging world. I can't say it any better than that, so I will simply add amen. With Doug, we pray for Marie, for stamina, as she and Kiva host our Halloween party later. It is absolutely tearing me up that I need to be asleep when that party starts, let alone partway through. Please give my love to everybody at the Halloween party. I have a particular love for Halloween, as you all know. And I miss Marie dearly. And so we pray for Marie for stamina. Just a Halloween party. Oh, God of stamina, hear our prayer. With Jeremy, I think we are all distressed by this government right now. And so I will pray, as I have often prayed, that a spirit of wisdom be upon those in power. A spirit of wisdom, hear our prayers. And we, with Jeremy, we also give thanks for sense of humor. Sometimes a good laugh is exactly what we need. And so this is exactly why I do Holy Hilarity after Easter. I believe it is absolutely a holy thing. And we give thanks for it. Oh, God of laughter, hear our prayer. Let's talk, we pray for Emmy. Who is nearing the end of her time in this world. And for Heather, and Laura, and Fenn, and Johnny, and Butterfly, all dear friends who are not currently with us, and whom we miss dearly. Oh God of healing, and what they call anticipatory grief in chaplaincy circles, hear our prayer. With Sally, we pray for children who are trying to keep up with school during COVID and who don't have adequate internet access or other resources. COVID has smacked around people who do not have resources at the best of times harder than it has hit anybody else. And so we pray for all of those people that they may receive what they need. Oh, sustaining God, our prayers. Within who we give thanks to God for months he didn't have any free day, and well, a long story short, he can hold Sabbath again, and that is so important. For the blessing of having a Sabbath and keeping it holy, we give thanks. O God who rested, hear our prayer. And with Jeremy, we pray thanksgiving for a breakthrough. O God of revelations, hear our prayer. And with Ibu, we pray for wisdom for further ways in November. A sneak sneak in the probable. Next station in my ways with God. Not sure what God wants him to do. So for a spirit of discernment, we pray. O discerning God, hear our prayer. And we give thanks for our friends, for the families we make. They help us all the time in ways that they don't even realize. O God of family, hear our prayers. Did I miss any of those? I got distracted kind of halfway through because some pigs were screaming. Yeah, I see you, Zoe. Thank you, Doug. Yeah, I'm sure you did. Yeah, and Zoe's over there popcorning, all happy as anything. She's very proud of herself. Well, if there was a prayer inside of you that you couldn't quite get out, it's okay. Like children at church, exactly. Because the psalmist tells us that God knows what we are going to say before the words can even form on our tongues. And yes, I used to. And so we know. We know that God has heard our prayers. Those spoken out loud, those typed into Second Life chat, and those spoken only in the silence of our hearts. And that we pray them in the name of the Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. I like that Amwin, Doug. We should do that from now on. Well, we have done a lot of talking. Let us take a moment of silence to listen to what God might be saying. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. Alpha and Omega, you are the one who makes all things new. As seasons come to an end, you turn the wheel and the new season begins. Guide us in this time of seasonal change in our lives, on the earth, and in our world. May the new season bring for us a hope for peace, a hope for justice. May the new season cause us to change our ways, to live into your hope for us. May we not despair because of the world humanity created, but may we rejoice because you are our creator. You made the heavens and the earth. You make all things new. Alpha and Omega, beginning and end. May we know a new beginning in you, in this moment, in the now. Amen. Those prayers, by the way, are written, I'm sure I've said this before, but I'm feeling it again tonight, the need to mention the Reverend Mindy Welton Mitchell, hyphenated married name and everything. Mindy was a classmate of mine at Ann Arbor Newton Theological School. She's an American Baptist preacher and writer, and I absolutely adore her. Her prayers, and she seems to strike a chord with you too. So I'm always grateful for Mindy. And now it really is just this simple. God loves you. So don't forget to love each other. Go with God, go in peace, And amen. Both of the songs we've heard tonight have plenty of really fun covers. There's even a version of Born to be Wild covered by Ozzy Osbourne and Miss Piggy. I encourage you to go find it later. It is very amusing. But, believe it or not, I think this is cuter.
Wild thing, bum bum, bong ding, you make my heart sing. Bum,
ding, hey, Kermit, what are you doing?
Oh, hi, Floyd. I'm just playing an unplugged version of Wild Thing on this ukulele here.
Oh, yeah, well, you see, Animal wanted to play the drums on this
okay.
one.
Okay. Plug in!
Sure. Yikes!
Yeah!
Ah!